I can't give a better solution to population collapse than the ones that are already being discussed by others. But I will give you a viewpoint, a lens to look at these large-scale global problems in a way that doesn't make you feel helpless, anxious, or indifferent as an individual. The starting point for solving population collapse lies in youth and family-focused policies, but policies by themselves are not going to solve the problem. They're more like a platform to get things started. But if we think about world population the same way we thought about it back in the 20th century, then we are doomed to cycles of depopulation and repopulation narratives. Like today, we are thinking that we need more people. But then sometime in the future, when we approach Earth's carrying capacity again, we'll feel like there's too many of us. We'd be stuck farming ourselves to save the market sometimes and to save the planet at other times. This kind of survivalism is a depressing way to view our present and future as humans. I'll double down on this using an analogy drawn by Devin Erickson, the author of one of the most enjoyable sci-fi reads I've had in recent times. So he once tweeted about the devil's hole pupfish, a fish that lives in what is essentially an isolated water-filled crack in the middle of a desert. The entire world of the fish exists within that crack. Today, there are 500 of them living in that puddle, and their food comes from the microbes or algae that grow within that puddle. That is all the food they have. And so, whenever their population goes beyond a certain threshold, they starve to death. Their population falls down to something like 30, and then they repopulate again. Now, if those puddlefish could make policies, they would make policies with the assumption that the knowledge and resources available to them will remain limited. Throughout our history, and even in present times, humans have often made the same mistake, although the rate of these mistakes have been going down. You see, puddlefish have two limitations that humans don't. Firstly, they can't just walk out onto the desert and search for new places to settle in. Unless some biological mutations make them evolve into a different species, they can't do that. Humans, on the other hand, have never been doomed to a specific habitat. From caves to mountains, to plains, to rainforests, to frozen wastelands, oceans, and even space. Humans have been in all kinds of places because we are not dependent on biological evolution to adapt to new environments. We rely instead on our research and inventiveness to create the tooling that is necessary to survive in that environment. Secondly, puddlefish can't extract more from their existing habitat. Humans, 10,000 years ago, lived on the same planet as we do and were the same species as we are. But unlike us, they were unable to fly across continents, grow food at will, eradicate diseases, or communicate through long distances at the speed of light. The same species, the same planet, and yet vastly improved utilization of resources over time. Again, we don't need to rely on biological evolution to climb the Kardashev scale. Unlike puddlefish and other animals, humans are an epistemological anomaly that can just keep creating new knowledge through conjecture and criticism. And you have inherited the brain of this inherently inventive and exploratory species, a species that started out as cavemen and is today on the verge of becoming a space-faring civilization. So, of course, you feel a sense of existential angst when your worldview is that of a puddlefish, all about preserving and distributing limited resources. That kind of thinking is against your nature. In the coming years, within your lifetime, the Earth will become increasingly abundant for humans. We'll start large-scale utilization of nuclear power, a cleaner and cheaper energy source, leveraging the resulting abundance in compute alongside rapidly advancing artificial intelligence. We will reach long-standing energy milestones such as nuclear fusion and viable solar energy. Even before all of that, we will find a way to extract minerals from asteroids and offshore heavy industry entirely onto other planets to keep the Earth green and cozy for ourselves. And yes, we will also figure out how to terraform Mars. We don't know how to do any of that yet, but when has that ever stopped us? There are thousands of engineers and entrepreneurs who are coming together to solve these extremely hard and exciting problems. And the truly amazing thing is that the people who work on such cutting-edge problems don't just do this for boring reasons like saving the planet or making money or gaining status or creating shareholder value. Those are secondary motivations. Some of them are a real hassle. The primary motivation behind all breakthroughs in both tech and media is the fun of doing it. The intellectual invigoration felt by the people putting in that pioneering effort. Today, not only are more and more talented people working on frontier fields, but also the percentage of the total human population getting into startups and independent media is increasing like crazy. I'm not worried about the population problem. Yes, it is getting bad, but the South Koreans will figure out how to save themselves. Humanity at large will save itself. Our species is going to keep ascending exponentially, whether or not you and I believe in the human capacity for infinite progress. What does bother me is how a lot of times we don't think about how remarkable civilization already is. The fact that I can speak with so many people across the planet is not natural at all. Civilization is probably not an emergent property of nature. All of this is kept alive by the intention and actions of individuals. So the fact that we have been on this trajectory for thousands of years and hundreds of generations is because the invention and scaling of technology is organic, positive sum, and intrinsically motivating for us. The moment we forget that, it becomes very easy to settle into the puddlefish outlook. And that is when we feel a sense of angst, meaninglessness, low agency, and eventually a hollow indifference. Let's not subject ourselves to that. Look at the world and wonder and stay optimistic. Thank you for listening.